Hello, thank you and welcome. Thank you for joining us for Emerge's weekly interview series where we talk with women elected officials. We are excited to be joined today by Commissioner Kristen Ang, who is the Tacoma Commissioner, Port of Tacoma Commissioner, and also an Emerge Washington alumna. As a Port of Tacoma Commissioner, she is focused on environmental leadership, building a collaborative community and relationships, and also creating economic opportunity for all of Pierce County. On top of that, she is committed to increasing the competitiveness of the Gateway, building a sustainable blue economy, and creating an innovative, smart, world-class port. So thank you so much, Commissioner, for joining us today.
Well, thank you, Ryan. Thank you for inviting me here. Glad to be here at Emerge at Work.
Great. Thank you again. So Emerge has over 1,000 women who are currently serving in office, but you are the first port commissioner that we featured on the show. So let's start with the basics. What is the responsibility of a commissioner of a port?
Well, first of all, let's start with the port, because some people don't know, and some people even who live around Washington don't know, even though we have 75 ports. A port, its primary purpose is economic development. And that can include developing marine terminals, airports, promoting tourism and trade. For me, as Port of Tacoma, we have 2,000 acres on the Tide Flats. I'm also, as part of being Port of Tacoma, I'm also a managing member of the Northwest Seaport Alliance, which is our partnership with the Port of Seattle with regards to marine cargo operations. And that brings in about $5.8 billion a year in our state. We are the most trade-driven, trade-dependent state in the United States, with about 40% of our jobs related to trade and about almost 50,000 jobs too in our area. So that's a lot of economic activity. And as some people know, our cities, Seattle and Tacoma, was created from the maritime. They call it the City of Destiny, Tacoma. That's where the rails and the sails, because this was picked as the western terminus of a railroad back in the late 1800s. And this was just how our city was created and wealth was created here. And that comes with many things. And I think people should understand that history moving forward. And I believe these kind of economic engines is where women should be. They should be representative and communities of color and those who have not had a say in our economy. As port commissioner, I and along with other commissioners sets the policy, the guidelines, approve and adopt the budget, evaluate. And so it's important that we are representative of our communities and we listen to them.
I love that. And now I know so much more about Tacoma and ports. Thank you so much for that explanation. So why did you run for this office specifically, and what are you hoping to accomplish in this role?
Sure. You know, I ran actually twice. What? In 2017, I saw no one running for office and I filed last hour. It cost less than a Katy Perry ticket that my little cousin paid for. And there was a fossil fuel project that really sent our community up in an uproar, because we have a history of Superfund sites and a toxic legacy that we have been moving away from. And to see that this was going to come into our area and that we would be a sacrificial zone, because the history of Tacoma for 100 years was that the health of people around here were sacrificed, and that had generational impacts on health, investment, and economic development. And we were like, no, we want to have a say. And so since no one was running and I wanted this conversation, I said, I can't ask of anyone what I won't ask of myself. And so I ran. It was for about environmental sustainability and leadership in our area and region, and for our community to have a say for what our future is going to be and who actually benefits from this, from the investments, right? And so that's why I ran the first time, and to prove that you don't have to be a political scion, you don't have to be the CEO of a Fortune 500 company or a maritime dynasty. And that's who usually runs for port and are in seats or part of the port. And I'm a political outsider who didn't know about LD, legislative districts, and all that. And I ran and I almost won with no endorsements, with whatnot, right? And that suddenly I'm viable, this woman of color, who came out of nowhere. I was called the young woman who ran for port because there were five older white guys who were running for a different port position, and I was the sole woman. So that's what they called me at first. The second time around in 2019, after Emerge training, I had the endorsements, I had the money. I went from the editorial board calling me fantastical to the next generation of leaders. Like, the platform that I had and the vision that I had with my community about environmental leadership, economic development, our improving our relationship with the Puyallup tribe that has historical tensions with the port here in Washington. Well, that became the platform of those in 2019. That was now the conversation that everyone had by the end of 2019. And that just proved to me that there was a vision that my community wanted, and that I needed to run on that. And we won, and it was historical because I ran on that platform. Plus I had the historical endorsement of the Puyallup tribe. It was about somewhat reconciling our histories, improving our relationships, and a different type of idea of what economic development could look like, community collaboration, and reaching out to our educational institutions.
I love so much of that answer. Really glad you're in this role without being, you know, the descendant of a maritime dynasty. But, you know, it happens so often that women run for office and they feel kind of discouraged when they don't make it the first time. And I think it's just so important that women run for office again, but also recognize just by being in the race the first time, they're starting to change the culture, change the narrative, and raise issues that are otherwise not raised, right? I think it's really telling that you ran, and it seems like a similar platform in 2017 and 2019, but in 2019, everyone else was talking about it too, right?
Yes.
You started it 2 years earlier.
I think in 2017, I had the most downloaded podcast for politics.
Oh.
And nobody usually looks at these positions. Neither did I. I'm going to confess that before 2017, I didn't really look at who was running for port. It was just so happens that I looked this year and saw nobody was about to run. And I was like, well, you can't really just protest and think that something's going to happen. You have to go after these seats.
Mm-hmm.
Be many, many, I would say, prongs to political change. That is getting these seats and being elected leaders, as well as the activism, the protesting, the community organizing, all those goes together. But I said, you know, hey, you could instead of protesting, we could just have the seat and make the difference. Difference between being called fantastical and far is just 51%. And eventually what was called then maybe far out there, now it's like common sense. Right. That's what people in my community think. Like, it actually, what I was saying was the practical and common sense. It isn't, I wasn't saying like, let's hug a tree. I was like, thriving in the 21st century is not about just tree huggery. It's about it's about environmental leadership, stewardship. We are at the intersection of nature and industry at our port.
Mm.
And I think the challenge of our times is creating that clean, just, and prosperous economy that has economic opportunity for all, especially marginalized communities that have been kind of shut out of these communities. Like, there is a history in Tacoma called the Tacoma Method, in which after the Chinese built the railroads, the mayor and other civic leaders and hundreds of people basically violently evicted them from here and sent them on a train to Portland. And so we do have this history that we are trying to move away from and reconcile, as well as with our tribal relationships. And that's the thing that I ran on. And people usually don't run on these kind of platforms or think they're important, but they're very important. Yeah. They're the key to our prosperity and for us moving forward.
Wow. It is just so evident that you are deeply connected to your community, right? You were born in the Philippines. You grew up in Tacoma. You also have a background and experience in law, economic development, and transportation. So I'm curious how these experiences helped you inform your priorities and the commission.
I would say it was helpful to have degrees. I think putting it on there, nobody questioned the intelligence factor, which often women do, even when they do have the degrees. The fact that I have business and law, I can understand and I can speak those languages. But it was also the traveling that made me see that we appreciate here in the Pacific Northwest, the natural environment. We think that's important, a treasure that we need to pass on for seven generations onward and onward. And that's worth preserving. I've also seen some areas in the world where people were sacrificed for other people's economic benefit, and they thought they were getting these jobs. Instead, they got a mudslide in their village, and the company that took advantage didn't help them out of that. And I didn't want to see that for our area. I wanted to see us move forward. And that informs me as well as history. Being an immigrant and kind of being an outsider, you know, I've been an immigrant, I'm a lesbian, I'm part of the LGBTQ community. If there's a minority, I'm probably one of it. And so it's kind of obvious. And nobody thought at first that someone like me could be viable, but it wasn't just the, I would say, the facial change that I was bringing to the commission. It is about ideas, mindset, and culture. So that is what I am bringing to the commission is about. It's not just this, it's about innovation, diversity. It's these kind of ideas that will make us succeed and move forward. And reaching out to people, there's a reason why some people email me or want to come in touch with me, because I'm accessible. People feel more comfortable because I've been out there in the community going, making the rounds, whether in the boardrooms or on the streets or in the churches or in the protests, activism, community organized. It's, you have to be there everywhere and feel that your community has to feel accessible to you because you could be missing out. And as an immigrant and outsider, I know how that feels. I can somewhat read people's feelings and know that sometimes there's a language barrier and you have to speak in certain ways to different people. You may have like some ideas and passions and actions, but you have to communicate that. And you have to also understand where other people are coming from. And when you've been an outsider, I think it's easier for you to understand that, especially when you haven't been part of that particular port. Not, there's strengths in there too, but you can also see what's been going on outside and you're not tied to the system yet. You can see maybe where things can be improved or things where their strengths, they don't even know what their, sometimes what their strengths are and how strong they are, right? And that's what I want to empower. Like, I've talked about environmental in my campaigns and you would think that I am the port would think that I am saying these things, but actually while I've been commissioner, I've been promoting the port's environmental team and leadership because they have done some good jobs, but that is sometimes not taken a look at by the people because it's not thought of as the most important. But during our strategic plan, I made it a priority, put it in our mission statement. Let's say diversity, equity, and inclusion. I don't want just that now that we're going to recognize that as a value. I want that as a pillar because I know that will have actions. And that's what people are now talking about. The port and DEI work, regional equity, equitable recovery. That's the word that everyone's now talking about in economic development. When I'm as a port commissioner, I get to sit on other boards in the state and the region. And sometimes I'm the only woman on economic development, which is shocking. And I'm the one who's bringing up childcare infrastructure. If you're talking about bringing more women into the recovery, well, what we saw in COVID was that when education was hit or any other things, women were the ones who were responsible, more responsible about childcare. And if you want them back into the workforce, we're gonna have to think about childcare infrastructure. Or let's say, because I come from the Philippines and I am aware of vaccine inequities. And I heard cries from people in the Philippines saying, we don't have any, why are you hoarding it over there? And so I asked one of our staffers, look, we're doing vaccines for our staff. Can't we do it for the seafarers who come from these countries that have been ravaged by coronavirus, who lack access, who can't, their governments seem to not be able to obtain these kind of vaccines, like what we consider world class. And the staffer actually appreciated that I asked him to stretch himself, and he did it. He was able to get people together, and Seafarers Association of our region from Seattle to Tacoma, and was able to get vaccines into seafarers who had foreign flags, who are considered undocumented, but they're part of our supply chain. They're the ones who got us our goods. They deserve a shot. They've been experiencing, I would say they've been captive on some of these ships for this past year because of COVID. And it's just the right thing to do. And maybe that the mindset of someone who's coming from a different perspective thought that was important, thought that should be a priority, that we at least could do that. And we did. And I think we were the first port, or maybe the only port, that did that. And even though it's not like, you know, all seafarers, or maybe not even the biggest number, I thought that was important to them. And it showed that we are doing something, we can do something. And that for me, or like environmental leadership, I want us to be like one of the greenest ports. And most people would say like, oh, environmental, that just means that just cuts our bottom line. I said, no, that actually makes you competitive. That is what we need to start doing, infrastructure, investments in infrastructure for the transition to a cleaner energy. That actually will bring about economic development in our area. And there's a lot more people who agree with that. And I'm finding that more and more. Or let's say our relationships with the Puyallup tribe of Indians. Look, we share land here. They still also have these, and we also have to always address the rights. It only makes sense that we improve our relationship, like litigation and having this land claim settlement of the largest land claim settlement in the 1990s. We weren't supposed to be static. We were supposed to maintain that and improve our relationship to the point where we're aligning our interests and actually going into business together, collaboration, right? That's the key to our area, is if we can actually collaborate. And so those are the things that I put into my mindset, as well as education, because I often think like, hey, my mom always said, because she is also an immigrant, that education is the key for us to get out of poverty. Mm-hmm. And so an opportunity. And I keep that in mind when I think of who's in my area, this region, and bringing it all together. And I often think like, hey, if there's going to be this blue economy, green economy, it has to happen ground zero here at our ports, the transportation hubs, in our area.
Yeah. Commissioner, you're just blowing my mind with all the things that your role touches, encompasses, and all the positive changes that you've been able to make from this position of power. And I am so grateful that someone with not only your like academic and professional experience, but your lived experience is now in this role and working to make positive change. Thank you so much for joining us. And thank you all who are joining us on the YouTube for another episode of Emerge at Work. Subscribe to our channel for updates and more great conversations with Emerge leaders from coast to coast. Thank you and have a great day.
Thank you.